нам такого не надо.
Надо.
Надо, да. Ладно, все, договорились. Все потом сделаем. Чтобы отец не всех перепугал. Так, Юрий, как будет. Да,
нашего гостя, профессор Тулио Раул.
Okay. Yes. I prefer better. Okay. When they asked me to give a conference, I just give that name, Omics of Cancer Cells. But when I finished the conference, I realized that I will talk about cancer cell genomics, because most of the data that already is published on cancer cells is related with genomics, and not with proteomics or metabolomics or other omics. So I will refer particularly to cancer cell genomics. I will try to explain a little about cancer as a genomic disease, the application of next generation sequencing in cancer, how to annotate, interpret, and report data on genomics, a little about how this data could be used for precision medicines, and at the end, I just will show you some database that you could use because most of the data is free. If you have an original questions that you things that you can solve, so you could go to this data, download, and make the analysis. If you look at the human genome as the normal human genome, a cancer cell, as this is an example of glioma, you will find that it is evident that the cancer is a disease of the genome. You could look here different structural alteration as chromosomes 1, deletions on chromosome 9. Another alteration that you could see very easy, so karyotype still is a good tool for the description of tumoral cells. But if you want to have a complete picture of the genome of the cell, of the tumoral cells, you need to look at point mutations, copy number alteration, structural rearrangement, look for regulatory elements and genes, then study how this influence on pathways. Okay, it's done functions. And also look at epigenetics modifications, because all of them contribute to the development of tumors. In general, if you take the cells, if you look how the organisms develop from the fertilized egg to the adult, there are many cells that divide And depending on the type of cells, and depending also on the environment and lifestyle exposure, you get mutations. But not all of these mutations provoke or promote cancer. And these mutations are called passenger mutations. But when you acquire a new mutation, that gives the cell the ability to proliferate, and then you get a second mutation that also is important, you develop tumors, you start to develop tumors, and after some mitosis, when this tumor is already detectable, you get a treatment. But again, as there are many different kinds of cells bearing different mutations, you get resistance to the tumor. So at the end, you have here between 1 and 10 driver mutations, or mutation that allows the cells to promote, to proliferate in normal conditions. But if you look how this happens, you in this picture is from the Lawrence paper in Nature 2013, you could see that and in this axis is a frequency of mutation. These are the tumors. Each spot is a sample, a tumor sample. You could see that sample, that tumor that occurs in children as neuroblastoma, medulloblastoma, contains a low number of mutation, a low number of frequency of mutation. But tumors that are present in adult persons usually has a higher frequency of mutations, and also this is associated with the lifestyle, as you see here. But sometimes you found some tumors, like this one, a neuroblastoma in a child, that also contain a large number of mutations. But this particular tumor, the authors found mutations related with the mechanism of repair of DNA. Okay, so as I told you before, not all mutations promote the development of tumors. Some of them, as I told you before, are passenger mutations, thus don't affect the proliferation of the cell, don't give any advantage over the rest of the cells. So one important task in bioinformatics is to identify which are really driver mutations, because these driver mutations are mutations that we could use to control the tumors. And I'll just give you an example of what happened in tumors. There is an activation of oncogenes. Usually these are mutations in the active site of the proteins, and also the gain in copy number of these genes. And also you could have a loss of functions of tumor suppressor genes, also by mutations or the loss in copy number. So one particular task is to identify in the all variants that you identify, all variants in the cancer genome, which really are important for the development of the tumor. And Hanahan in 2011 described the principal characteristics of tumor cells. The abilities that allows these cells co-opting normal cell behavior. After that, he also published another paper in which include other characteristics as the energy metabolism and the particular characteristic of tumor cell to evade the immune system. So most of the genes that are related or are considered drivers affect any of these functions. But another complex question when you are doing work with cancer is that cancer is not the homogeneous culture. The tumors are very heterogeneous. You will find several and different subpopulations, each of one contain different mutations. Each of one of these subpopulations are in different composition. And if you look, one of the proposals that has been doing bad thing in 2012 is that cancer are a mix of subclones that can respond directly to therapy. If you observe from here, when some of cells start to proliferate, they acquire some mutations that are common to all subpopulations. But after that, they start to get new characteristics or new mutations. When you identify a patient with a diagnosis of cancer and you start the chemotherapy, you are able to reduce these populations like this. Even some of them, you could eradicate completely. But then after some time, some of the population that were not eradicated start to grow and expand, and new mutations arise. So this is why most of the therapies until now fails to eliminate tumors. The other aspect in cancer genomics is that usually during the life of the patients, there is a capacity of some tumors to provoke metastasis. And when you look also, when you sequence the original tumor and tumors located in other regions or metastasis, they almost all of them contain some of the subpopulation of mutations, but also there is a gain in new mutations, and you could differentiate between the primary tumor and secondary metastasis and tertiary metastasis cells. So the reason or why this is important, the cancer genomics, is because you could improve the treatments, knowing the susceptibility of the patients to develop some response to predict adverse side effects. Because you could predict also the drug resistance and metabolism of the drugs that you are using. If you look at the enzymes that are responsible for the metabolism of these drugs, but also you could study in the inherited cancer syndromes, the patients, the family members, but you also could do the prognosis about the patients, how long it will survive based on molecular subtyping, analyzing whether or not the tumor is benign or malignant, and also predict the metastatic potential. So what are the targets in the tumors? These are what we are talking now is which are the driving mutations. And to know that, we need to sequence. Maybe it's in the sequence mutations. Maybe it's in the structure of the genome, copy number variations. Maybe it's in the function, in the function of the genes, because there are different expression due to mutations in the promoter or methylations or things like that, or exon usage, or maybe there are external factors like virus and bacteria. So to know about this, what usually we do, or people do, I'm not doing this, is to sequence the genome. And this is a very general picture of what we what is doing. I will not talk about this. But one problem when you get the sequence, or one of the problems when you get the sequence, is that many algorithms that do the read, align the reads to a human reference genomes. And depending on which tools you use, maybe you get different picture. So one important thing that you should always look is which are the algorithms or which are the pipeline that authors use to describe the mutations or to describe what they observed in the tumor cells. By sequencing, you could detect everything in the genome. You could detect point mutations, you could detect indels, you could detect copy number alteration, translocations, breakpoint, also the presence of pathogens. But the question is, which of the next generation sequencing technology you use? You could use whole genome sequencing or exome sequence, or JOTS, look for sequence only genomes related with cancer, exomes of genomes related with cancer, or you could study epigenome modifications or do RNA-seq. So you could do everything depending on the money you have. But it is important to know that depending on the method you use, you will get different results. If you are using genome sequencing, complete genome sequencing, and this is an example on the Carras genome from the Broad Institute, you will get about 40 coverage of all the bases of the genome, and maybe you could get a good results if the purity of the tumor is high, if there are not many subpopulations. But if there are many subpopulations and the tumor, when you get the sample of the tumor is not pure, then you need to do exome or RNA-seq that provide you with more coverage. Again, if you using next-generation sequencing, you could identify epigenetic modification that is in this case, that is related with the expression or inactivation of the expression of the different genes. And these data are complementary and confirmatory. So sometimes it is enough to do a genome sequence, but if you also do exome or RNA-seq or methyl-seq, you get more data on what happens in this tumor. Let's talk a little about somatic mutations. In somatic mutations are detectable at very low coverage. Let's say in this example, the total coverage is 19, so it is okay, because there is only a difference in one allele to the second. But if you are working with a tumor, as I previously mentioned, is a mix of cancer and normal cells, then you need a higher coverage. The second problem is pointed out by this author in this paper, that all samples or tumor samples are different. And sometimes the DNA quality and quantity is not the best for to do the work. So this is another consideration. So maybe you want to do or you have the money to do RNA-seq, DNA-seq, but the amount of sample is minimal, so you should decide which is the best for the project in the moment you are. The other problem is that tumor genome has different copies, as I showed in the second slide. And this is also a factor that you should take into account when you are examining the data. So for to detect mutation, to detect mutations in samples with low purity or high ploidy, you need a higher coverage. So it is not possible to detect using genome sequence. You need to do exome sequence. The second point is that to study tumor purity, ploidy, and subclonal structure, it is important to have the coverage of the genome. And usually, you need to do this by exome sequence. And in this case, this is a publication from Favero in 2015. He used a software to detect or to determine the tumor content in the sample and tumor average ploidy. So this is a good example where you analyze data and you could propose how pure is the sample you start to work. And in this case, in ROS, in 2014, he shows that using this program is possible to detect driving mutations, but also clonal mutations in all tumor cells, and also the subclonal population with some mutations particular to these cells. Let's talk when you design or when you analyze data and you decide these are the important genes, probably these are the driving genes, you need to verify this. And this could be do it by different methods. Some of them by PCR in, this is another sequencer, PacBio, or using Illumina capture method, hybrid capture Illumina method. That's only analyze the genes or the mutations that you want to detect. The mutation detection sensitivity is also a problem and is detected by the DES, as I told you before, but also by the sequencer and polymerase error. There is a sequencer error rate, even if you want to detect a mutation that is present in a tumor in very low proportion, it is not possible because there is also a sequencing error rate. And in this zone, there is confounding data. But with exome data, you could study subclonability if you get sufficient coverage of the sequence. In relation with somatic copy number and structural alteration, there are still technologies that allow you to identify which aberrations occurs in the tumor. And this is an example. In this case, each chromosome is painting with different fluorophore. So it's very easy to identify where occur translocations or like in this case in which we have a fragment of the chromosome 10, and here a fragment of the chromosome 13. So it's quite easy to identify the structural aberration. And if you go and you want to use sequence technology to study gains and losses of copy numbers, then you need to go to tumor exome sequence, because this gives you a better picture than other techniques. Again, it is possible to interpret existing clinical data. In this case, it's possible to show the amplification of the EGF receptor, and in this case, the loss of P10. But also, you could study the exact breakpoints. For instance, in the EGF receptor, this is an important mutation related with breast cancer. And in this case, you will observe after sequencing that there is a missing reads from this region and occurs a breakpoint between this and this region, giving you a shorter C-terminal of this gene. But also, it's possible to analyze other structural rearrangement, as in this case, where the situation is a little more complicated with highly complex and rearrangement in tumor cells, but you could detect this at base pair resolution. And again, you will have some tumors in which there is a high number of structural variation, like in this lung adenocarcinomas, and others in which there is not detectable or a small amount of rearrangement. So talking now about the RNA-seq. RNA-seq is important because it could detect the difference in exome usage. And this is an example given by Griffin in 2010. In this case, he developed two cell lines, one that is sensitive and the other is resistant to 5-fluorouracil. In this case, after sequence, he detected different usage between sensitive and resistant cell line by skipping off one of the exomes. But also, you could do expression profiling and subtyping of tumors. That is very inconvenient in when you are trying to prognose whether the tumor is resistant or not to a treatment, or whether you have more survival than others. But also you could detect pathogens, like in this case, the Ester Byron Girón in the lung adenocarcinoma. But it is okay when you found all the variants, but in one individual comparison to another, we have more than 2 million of variants. So what it is important is to detect the relevant variants in the tumors. Sometimes you need to also do the sequence of the normal tissue of the patient, usually from blood, to compare between the mutations and in the tumor and the normal sequence of the in the normal cell. So one important task in these studies are the annotation, interpretation, and reporting of the data. So to do this, there are many variants, but you need to do a lot of work. First, you need to have a clinical indication and history of the family. You need to look at locus-specific and variant database. You need to have into account the population frequency that change from one population to another. Then you need to look at public database, publications, how the ones amino acids, the relevance of the amino acid substitution or amino acid conservation. Look for prediction tools, whether or not the substitution of one amino acid by another is relevant or not, is important, is pathogenic or benign. Look at the splicing prediction tools, and then look at druggable targets and pathways. But there is a persistent bias in sequencing. Up to now, 81% of the genomes published is European ancestry. In China now, there is a 1 million project. So maybe this picture changed, and 81% of the genomes will be from China, and the rest from the rest of the ethnic groups. And in the case of Cuba, this is a problem because the published genomes related with Hispanic and Latin American is only 0.54%. So it's very low, the amount of information. So when you are looking whether this variant that you observe in a cancer genome is relevant or not, it is the amount of data is still very small. So but there are different software that you could use for the annotation. The annotation could be done in automatic ways or also manual annotation, but again, you need to check each mutation. It's not an easy work. You could use different tools to do this. But maybe you describe a novel variant. And this novel variant, you should give a qualification. This is a benign variant or a pathogenic variant. And for this, you should get population data, whether or not this is frequent in your population or not. This is as frequent, this variant is not relevant for tumors. Then you have to perform computational and predictive data, functional data if possible, but nobody does this because it's almost impossible to verify the importance of each mutation. Then you need to segregate data, analyze de novo data, study the allelic data, and also look for another databases. And after, in particular for cancer, there is a database that contains genes that up to now has been relevant or related with the development of tumors. When I put this slide, maybe 2 months ago. These were the data that they show. I forgot to put here when I visit the place. But I visit today, and there is a difference. So I would just want to point out that even when you finish to analyze your data, if you analyze again the same data in 1 year, you will get different panorama of your results. So don't please take this into account, because information is accumulated and you need to again do the same analysis to look if you could get more data from this. In particular, there is a notation of more variance. One tumor disappeared from this collections, and again, several drugs were not consistent, the results with the variations or with the gene. So these genes, from this amount of genes, some of them already have drugs. And we call these actionable mutations. In this picture, I just want to point out these are 37 genes that already you have a drug that can control the tumor. And you could divide this in 4 pathways, RTK, RAS, RAF, all these genes, P3, KEY, ATK, mTOR pathway, cell cycle, and P53 DNA repair pathways. And just to show you that up to now, most of the drugs has been used for a specific location. But as more data emerge, now it's more clear that you could use a drug independent on the location of the tumor. If you have the similar genetic defect, and for instance, in here, you can use the same drug for different kind of tumors. The second is that you could benefit for a combination of therapy if you use a therapy, again, this pathway and this one. And then that's half of the tumor has at least 2 disruptive drug-like pathways. So that means that a combination of therapies would be better benefit patients. And this is, there are now several clinical trials that are trying to demonstrate this idea. So how do you report the results? There is, I think, more questions, ethical questions. What happens is you discover mutations not related with tumors that also could affect the patient in other meanings or give you predispositions to some other disease. You should communicate the patients or not? These are still our questions that people are trying to elucidate. But again, what people or what doctors receive is a list, a very big list, that maybe is useful for them or maybe it's not. But they are what is trying to do is to analyze this in the context not of gene by genes, but in the context of regulatory signals and signaling pathways, try to identify which are the important targets on these pathways. Again, this is a tumor driven by RET upregulation. This is a gain of copy number variation, pitting loss. This is a tumor suppressor gene, and there is no alteration in this targetable gene. But after, so what the oncologists receive is based on all this information, which are the possible drugs that he could use based on the known mechanism and indication of these drugs. And some already targeted therapies exploit this information from cancer genome sequence. I just show you two examples. In this case, this is an activation of the mutation due to the is a lung adenocarcinoma with activated mutation of the EGF receptor. He receives antibodies against this receptor, and again, you see here the effects on tumor reduction. And the second example is a metastatic melanoma with activated mutation of BRAF, received a specific BRAF drug. And you see here in green is the metastatic melanoma, and here the patient after the treatment. But as I mentioned before, the resistance arises. So again, you need to sequence the genome of these tumor cells and find or try to explain how this happens. So in this case, there is not already there is not a gain on RET, but there is activation on AKT1. So to overcome this mechanism of resistance, probably the information from genome sequence give us the sustain the use of cocktail of targeted drugs against multiple members of activated and parallel pathway, the detection of resistant mechanisms, and also impose the question, can resistant be modeled, monitoring? We should do serial biopsies, blood tests, to detect before the appearance of the novel tumors, which treatment we should give to the patient to prevent this resistance. Finally, I just want to show you some of the databases. Okay, this is the TCGA, the Cancer Genome Atlas. So here you will find all publications that releases related with this data until now. So if you have a new question, so please read the paper first, then ask the question, and then go to the data. And the data, you could go here. Launch, okay. There are several tools that you could use for interrogate this database. So there are 40 projects. This is the number of files. This is the number of sequence or exome sequence or so on. The information, the information about this number of genes, the number of cases, and the number of mutations that they detect. And here, how the cases for each one. You could explore this data, you could do the analysis, and you go to the repository and download specific data that you need for, again, doing some new analysis. The second database, or the second big project related with cancer genomics, is the ECGC. This is an international collaborative project. I think that China is by the cancer patients, including, I don't know if there is from Rocha, maybe. Okay, do you look later? No? Again, here is the information for the list of publications related with this data, and you also have access to all the data in this database. You could look the distribution of the distribution of tumor by cancers. You also have the information about top mutated cancer genes with high functional impacts. Again, this is a very similar picture as I showed you, a little different because only use the data generated by this project. And you could select whether or not and which kind of data you want to analyze. It provides with search option by primary site, gender, tumor stage, and also you could perform some data analysis. But again, if you want to do or perform particular kind of analysis, you need to download the data. Another database that contains information about genomes or cancer genomes is the cBioPortal. This is from, I forgot now. If opens, is okay, if not. Let's take it longer. Okay, these two sites you could also visit and you could get here a lot of information. In this case, in this database, you could get information about tumors. Also, it's a collection that is American collection is contains some of the data that are in the TCGA project, but also contains data that is not included in this project. And in the case of IntoGene, there is a database of driver genes, and you could find the frequency of the mutations of the genes, where these mutations occurs and the significance of the mutation to the tumor development. So, okay. Finally, this is the journal Yuri told you. You could visit this place. It's edited by our institution. It's referencing in Scopus, is a little fat, impact fat, but anyway, you could use for if you need to publish something. And this is just a view of our university in Havana.
К вашей лекции. Я помню, меня больше всего потрясла эта история с венерической саркомой собак и лицевым раком у этого самого дьявола. У человека ничего такого нет?
Не знаю, пока. Окей, не знаю, потому что...
Вообще, за исключением этих двух случаев, больше ничего такого нет.
Нет, у нас есть more data on this. Yeah, because я вообще говорю по-английски. Sorry. You are talking about the combination of interference that I showed in the previous lecture? No.
No, sorry. I'm just something completely different.
Okay.
Several years ago, they detected two cases of infectious cancer, yes. Like you know this venereal sarcoma in dogs and facial cancer in Tasmanian devils.
Yes, I know.
Case, you know, when the cancer cell become unicellular and
yes, I know.
Any case of this in human?
Yes, in ovarian cancer.
Really?
Yes.
Sorry, what?
Ovarian cancer. It's related with the herpes. No, is a. I don't remember which is the virus, but in ovarian cancer is related with the infection with virus.
No, but that's induced by the virus, but yes. The cancer cells itself are human cells.
Yes.
Yeah, in case of that dog cell, but they are transmitted.
No.
Nothing like this in humans.
No, I didn't listen
yet.
About this.
All right.
I have a question. One of these subpopulations of cells in different cancers, what is known about the interactions between these different subpopulations? Is it a studied issue? And are there any maybe subfunctionalization between these subpopulations?
Yes.
Are there any patterns, or is just too diverse to detect any patterns?
Yes, there is very well known that there is interaction between tumor cells and cells that surround the tumors. So maybe there is some interaction that favors the growth of both kind of subpopulations. But until now, I didn't saw any papers related with this. And why there are different subpopulations? Because in the process of tumorigenesis, the mutations occurs in different cells. And some cells has more advantage capacity to proliferate than others. So until these cells, these cells use all the mechanisms of the human body to grow. So until this, the other subpopulation is resting because not enough resources, could be factor, growth factors, or any other things to grow at higher rates. But when you treat the tumors and you eliminate this, the others start to grow.
When you show this, you know, the number of mutations in different sorts of tumor, what is just the number of mutations which are usually accumulated in the cells? Are there any difference in the threshold of mutation necessary to start the proliferation? Or is
just, yes.
Or just one is enough? No,
one is not enough. Uh-huh. One predisposes the cells to growth. Usually you need between 2 and 3 mutations. In colon cancer, it is very well established. First is APC mutation, then TP53, and then the third one, I don't remember exactly. It's the sequence. But in other tumors, it's a different sequence.
So it's always sequence. So if you have some, you know, gap in, you don't have intermediate mutation, doesn't go.
Probably, maybe it goes. The order maybe could change a little. Maybe you get first the first mutation, then the third,
and
the second.
No more questions? Okay, so I'm asking more questions. All right, that's another story. You said what that sort of a passenger mutation, or how you call it?
Passenger mutations.
Yeah. So most of them has to be, damaging, suppressing the proliferative rate. I mean, because they have to be adaptive.
Now this mutation,
so they can be sort of anti-cancer. The more they have passenger mutations, the less the proliferation.
The mutations are not selective. They occur randomly. So maybe some of them could be in response to proliferation. Uh-huh. But there is not too much, because you need to do functional studies. Uh-huh. And due to the high number of mutations, nobody take care of this. And it's a combination, and because there are not many tumors with the similar mutations, it is a waste of time to try to construct a cell with these two mutations and then add another and look what happens, because the combination is very high.
Yeah, I see.
Maybe bioinformatics could help to identify which one made, which combination of mutations.
That's one of the things. I don't understand what's the point about why it's so, diagnostical feature, or why is the loss of heterozygosity tell about anything? What do you mean, this loss of heterozygosity? That was one of the signs you used.
Yes.
Why is it so important? And how it happened?
I'm not familiar with this.
Okay.
Sorry, I will check and maybe. Well, with related with this, in the other presentation, I give some information because we know that interferon, alpha, and gamma have different pathways. That we propose is that the combination of both in different proportion could activate one or the second pathway. And in dependence on how this activation occurs, it could be advantage in resting tumor cell lines. Well, the combinations provoke is a resting cell cycle. It's not apoptosis or something like that.
Okay. So, well, your lecture was more understandable than most of Russian lectures, so you see, they understood all. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Следующая лекция, как вы помните, про...